listen to music. I'm just going to invite you to take your seats, and we're just going to sit and just listen and reflect.
Well, good morning. My name's Will. I'm the vicar here at St. Lawrence's. And today, on this sad occasion, it is a tremendous privilege to be able to take this service for John and for the family. We all share many memories with John. And there being so many here is a testimony to how many people and how many lives he touched. And I know that the hall, this is being live streamed, this service as well, and the hall is full of people in there, and there are people watching online. Each of you will have your own special memories with John for the times that you've shared with him, the places that you've met him, the places that you've known him. I know that when I was talking to Alison, she said, I have no idea who will be here. And what I would just say on her behalf, really, is please don't expect her to know who everyone is afterwards, and for Claire and James as well, and for the family. Please don't expect them to know. So you might just need to say to them, if you go and speak to them, who you are and how you knew John, because there were so many people that he knew. But yeah, just speak to them and let them know. Let's just take a moment to just be still, shall we, as we begin. We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you. We have come here today to remember before God our brother John, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, and to commit his body to be buried, and to comfort one another in our grief. And so I'm going to pray. God of all consolation, your Son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on your children in their loss. Give to troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen in us the gift of faith. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Every detail of this service was worked out by John with what he wanted, even to the extent of which lectern we used, which is why I'm stood to the side, because you wouldn't be able to see me behind it. John was very clear about what he wanted, that this was to be a celebration of his life. He chose the hymns. He always said as well that he didn't like it when they cut short the number of verses in hymns and things like that. And how he wanted it. And so we're going to stand and we're going to sing as we sing our first hymn together, As the Deer Pants for the Water. So if you're able, would you please stand?
Thank you.
if you'd like to take your seats. I'm going to invite Claire and James up as they're going to come and speak.
I don't think Dad thought about this, given how tall he was, how short he was even. He thought, oh yeah, I've got the kids to stand behind this, so we will stand by the side so you can see us.
John Edward Gibson was born on the 5th of January 1949 at 129 Tunstall Road, Knipersley, to Frank and Rose Ella Gibson, and was a younger brother of Alan. When Dad was diagnosed with a life-limiting illness, he started to write his memoirs to share his life before many of us knew him. He managed up to 1972, so the first part of these stories are from Dad himself. Dad's first home was the bungalow in Biddulph Park, opposite what was Patchett's shop. This was his family home for 6.5 years until the summer of 1955. The bungalow didn't have a flushing toilet, so the bogeyman would come once a week in the early hours of the morning to take away the tub under the toilet. If Dad had ever been naughty, which he says was very infrequent, he was threatened by being taken away by the bogeyman. Dad's experience of life on a farm started at a young age, as his grandparents lived in Gleeblow Farm. The farm was always an adventure. His granddad would milk the cows by hand, sitting on a three-legged stool. One hot summer's day, Dad was stood watching his granddad milk the cows, when his granddad then told him to stand next to him and open his mouth. He then squirted milk straight from the cow into Dad's mouth. There were plenty of fields for him to play in, and he would pick up eggs from the hencock. Some of the eggs were hatched by his grandma, so there would be chickens about the farm as well. Dad started school on his 5th birthday in January 1954. The school bus would pick him up outside the bungalow, and he would arrive at Biddulph North School, which is now the church hall here at St Lawrence. He only spent 18 months at this school, as the following summer he moved to Villa Close in Knipersley. This was a brand new house and much bigger than the bungalow, and it had an indoor toilet, a luxury. But not that my dad was ungrateful, he was sad to leave the bungalow, surrounded in countryside and fantastic views, to living in a small town. Dad then went to what is now Knipersley First School. He was happy at school, but was more interested in playing and learning. And he was then sent to Biddulph Hall Boys School at the age of 11, or the big boys school as Dad would call it. Dad's first job at the age of 13, he worked on a dairy farm not far from his grandparents' farm, Biddulph Park. This was also the introduction to life with tractors, as he would drive them and have to carefully reverse them into the cowshed for mucking out. At 15, the reality of life after school kicked in. A trip to Chatterley Whitfield Colliery helped to make the decision that he definitely was not going to be working down the mines, and he told his mum to not even think about asking him. So when he left school, he started work at Mills Hayes Garage in July 1964 as an apprentice mechanic. His main job was as a grease monkey at the start, then he progressed on to changing engine oil and filters and changing the spark plugs and helping in the body shop. Unfortunately, things didn't quite work out at the garage, but not only did Dad learn to service a car, basic bodywork and handle money, he also learned to stand up for himself, and after the foreman took a dislike to him, needless to say, Dad wouldn't stand for this, and he told the foreman to stick his job. Dad then worked very briefly at the local co-op shop until he saw an advert for a job as an apprentice joiner. He started his apprenticeship at Mr. Machin's workshop on John Street in September 1964, and this turned out to be the start of Dad's career in the building industry. Dad soon settled into this job, and the lads he worked with were great. He acquired the nickname Bone, as he was no further through than a wet sentinel. After a few weeks, his job was made permanent, and he was enrolled into college to study carpentry and joinery at night school. Dad continued to progress his learning, and eventually attained HNC in building construction. At college, the students were encouraged to down tools in order to progress, so in July 1972, he left Machin's and went to work for T&R's Chartered Quantity Surveyors in Shelton. Dad continued to progress in his work as a quantity surveyor, working for a few housing companies over the years, and he finished his working life at Bullock Construction in 2012 and retired at the age of 63.
Made it up to you, Rob. Dad met our mum in 1972 at Bradwell Methodist Church, where he was singing, and after a lot of faffing and being more interested in playing his guitar, they began courting in December 1972. He then didn't faff and bought a house whilst Mum was still at school, and they were engaged in July 1973. 1 year later, they were married at Bidulph Park Chapel and moved into number 2 Trently Drive, Bidulph Moor. In 1978, a very important event happened. Me, his little cherub. And for those that would like to know, the reason my name is spelt with no E is because the song Claire by Gilbert O'Sullivan is spelt that way on the LP. A song that he would sing to me many times over the years and was the ringtone on his phone when I called him. 2 years later, in December 1980, Dad got a colour TV and I got a brother called James. We lived at Trently Drive until May 1987. This was a happy home where Dad taught us both to ride a bike. He would build ramps for my brother in the drive to help with his daredevil antics. He also shaved off his moustache. He also shaved his moustache off, which made me cry. Dad was always out and about around the house, always building something, including a garage and a conservatory. He did get someone else to build the extension, but when he came home from work, he would change many things they had done and criticise their techniques. So instead of correcting other people's work, Dad then decided to design and build his own home. In May 1987, the Gibbos moved to Plot 2, Leet Lane, and lived in luxury in a 14-foot 10 caravan whilst Dad was building the family home. We moved into 6 Leet Lane in October 1987. Whilst not completed, it was better to have a chemical toilet in the airing cupboard than a caravan. Much mischief and adventures occurred during this time. I remember helping Dad with the insulation in the loft and was covered in fiberglass scratches. Dad got well busted by Mum when she got home. But I was more than happy to be helping my dad and getting stuck in. I also spent a lot of time in the garage with him, helping to get cars ready for their MOT, pressing the brake pedal to make sure the lights were working properly. If they weren't, it was a trip together down to Snelson's in Bidulph. Another important event in Dad's life was on the 5th of December 1998. Yes, it was my brother's 18th birthday, but Dad went missing all day, and when he returned, it was with his first classic car, a Morgan four-seater in Brunswick Green. Over the years, numerous tractors and classic cars appeared with or without Mum's knowledge or permission. Many were renovated from what others might see as scrap, and he returned them to their former glory. Whilst Dad needed no excuse to buy more Morgans, he found another one with the arrival of his grandchildren, coming shortly after his retirement. Billy arrived first in May 2015, followed by Jesse in September 2018. Dad was as proud as a grandparent could be, and marked the occasions as he knew best, by building them both their own mini Morgans, and earned himself the title of Granddad Cars. Dad was invited to display his three-wheeler Morgan on the Morgan stand at the NEC Classic Motor Show in 2013. Prior to the event, Dad was told that a special guest had asked for a personal viewing of his Morgan, as he had one as a young man. This special guest was Sir Stirling Moss. Dad was more than happy to show him around, and the photos taken show how much joy this brought to him. Dad's love of cars extended into one of the few sports he understood, Formula One. The sound of F1 engines on the TV have driven my mum nuts for many years. My favourite family holiday was in May 2019. We all went to Barcelona as a 70th birthday present for Dad from Mum. James and I trumped Mum with tickets to the Formula One race at Circuit de Barcelona. However, Karen trumped all of us by securing paddock passes on Friday's practice day. Dad and I wandered up and down the paddock, catching glimpses of Toto Wolff, and I have a lovely photo of Lewis Hamilton's bottom from that day. After a personal tour of the tyre setup, we were allowed into the safety car garage, and watched Lewis Hamilton exit his garage into the pit lane, which was right next to us. The sound of his car was incredible, and the memories I have of that day even better. As Dad would say, it was a grand day out. On the subject of holidays, we enjoyed many camping and caravan trips around the UK when we were younger. The trips to the beach were the most exciting and unique when it came to Dad. Not many people, if any, would pack a sledge for a summer holiday, but Dad did. He would pull me and James on it along the edge of the sea at full speed. Either Dad's legs would tire from the sprinting, or we would end up in the sea, absolutely soaked and probably with a mouthful of seawater, because we would be in hysterics, being dragged rapidly on the edge of the water. Dad had many interests in his life, including classic cars, tractors and anything you could build. But his true passion was music and singing. He was singing from around the age of 3 at the side of his grandma's piano and in the local chapel where she was the organist. Not only did he sing solos on Biddulph Park anniversary stage, but his grandma took him to other local chapels to repeat them at their anniversaries too. Dad was involved in school productions and has continued to sing all of his life. He was for many years choir master at St John's and directed musicals, etc. with Cypher. He found Monday night choir practices a release when work was stressful and greatly enjoyed weekends away singing their services in a number of cathedrals with Congleton Choral Society and taking part in productions such as Sweeney Todd and Amadeus at the New Vic with the Phoenix Singers. During COVID times, he sang more than ever, joining the isolation choir online. When Mum met him, he was singing at a chapel with the gospel group One Way, and there were many other groups and productions he was involved in, both sacred and secular. He also set up A Mind to Sing to help those with dementia and Parkinson's, and it was something he was particularly proud of. Sadly, in November, Dad reluctantly had to withdraw from his choir, finding it difficult to sustain notes and phrases and realising he couldn't manage a concert again. This caused him great upset, because he saw years ahead without singing, which had been part of his life for over 70 years. Notwithstanding the sadness at losing his ability to sing, Dad was always a positive person. It was one of his many fine traits that I admired, as I often felt his positive vibes rubbing off on those around him. Dad was many things to lots of people, and I'm sure that anyone who was fortunate enough to know Dad was proud to call him a friend. Just as we are both proud to say that he was our pops. So, if you're ever singing a song or hymn, belt it out like Dad did. If you're tinkering in the garage and get covered in sawdust or grease, think of Dad. If you see a classic car passing by, smile and know that the person driving that car is having the time of their life. If you're ever stuck behind a tractor, don't get frustrated. Take a moment to take in the country air and think of Dad. And if you're up on Top Road, know that the view from there was his favourite. Take a look around and think of Dad. Thanks.
Thank you both so much. Just some wonderful memories with John. We're going to take some time to just listen and reflect. One of the things that was mentioned was John's love of singing and of music, and he loved being in the choir, in the Phoenix Singers Choir. And he's requested that they sing a song for us, and we're going to take the time to just sit and reflect upon our memories with him as I invite the choir to sing. Thank you. I'm going to pray. Eternal God and Father, we praise you that you have made people to share life together and to reflect your glory in the world. We thank you now for John, for all that we saw of your goodness and love in his life, and for all that he means to each one of us. As we too journey towards death, may we do so in the company of Jesus, who came to share our life, that we might share the life of eternity. To him be glory with you and the Holy Spirit for ever and ever. Amen. And so, merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son, whom you raised from the dead. Strengthen our faith that all who have died in the love of Christ will share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to invite Andrew up and he's going to read for us.
The Bible reading is taken from Isaiah 40, and following John's request, it's in the Authorized Version. Have ye not known? Have ye not heard? Hath it not been told you from the beginning? Have ye not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof as grasshoppers. He that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in, that bringeth the princes to nothing. He maketh the judges of the earth as vanity. Yea, they shall not be planted. Yea, they shall not be sown. Yea, their stock shall not take root in the earth. And he shall also blow upon them, and they shall wither, and the whirlwind shall take them away as stubble. To whom then will ye liken me? Or who shall I be equal, saith the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high, and behold who hath created these things, that bringeth out their host by number. He calleth them all by names, by the greatness of his might, for that he is strong in power, not one faileth. Why sayest thou, O Jacob, and speakest, O Israel, my way is hid from the Lord, and my judgment is passed over from my God? Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint.
Thank you. If you're able, would you please stand? We're going to sing together our second hymn. you'd like to take your seats. Do you know, I find myself smiling to myself just at the end in that repeat chorus. One of the things that I remember so well with John is John would sing every week really here. He would sing in our choir in the morning with the organ playing. And if he felt there should have been a double chorus at the end, he would make sure he sang, and Linda would have to catch up on the organ, and John would sing, and we would all sing together. You know, John picked everything about this service. And his faith was so deep. He was once asked, he shared with me a story, and Alison shared it with me as well, how years ago someone was asking him and talking to him about his funeral, and he's saying, you know, what would we need? And he said, well, you need a cushion, because you need to make yourself comfy, because we're going to be there for a while. John picked everything. He knew what he wanted. I was told how even with this Bible reading, he first learned that reading, he said, when he did English literature at school rather than in church or in RE, and it had stuck with him since school days, and he wanted that particular version, the translation, as well. He had specific requests about how things were to be. We've mentioned this lectern already, and now having heard the Bible read, pardon? An eagle. Having heard the Bible reading, that might make a little bit more sense for you now. Because there is this eagle. And with the request, this carved eagle, which was to be used, there's obvious links with the reading and obvious links with John. John was a skilled craftsman. He was a skilled woodworker. He was a skilled engineer. In every sense, his attention to detail, his skills, he loved things to be just right. And when I looked at this eagle, I found myself thinking about John's skills and how when this was carved, originally, it would have been blocks of wood. And someone, a creator, a craftsman, saw what could be rather than the raw wood that they were faced with. They saw what could be carved away and etched out into the shape of something else. John, when he saw things, he didn't see things the way they were. He saw what could be. When he got those old beaten up tractors, when he got the old Morgans, the cars, when they bought the plot of land and lived in a static caravan, John didn't see what was there. He saw what could be. And in this reading, the book of Isaiah, well, the book of Isaiah was written at a time when the Jewish people were in exile in a place called Babylon. Their circumstances, well, they weren't great. They were taken, they were captive, they were in a foreign land. And in the book of Isaiah, chapters 1 to 39, talk about God's judgment if the people place their trust in the secular rulers rather than God. But at chapter 40, there is this switch in the whole book, this turning point, where actually the book now focuses on redemption. The promise of redemption and a hope that lifts beyond the circumstances. See, when the Jewish people looked round in the world they were living in, what they saw wasn't good. But in this reading and in the following chapters, what we get are verses of what could be, not of what are. There's this contrast throughout the passage between God and us, that God is God and we are not. God, the creator that knows each of us by name, that knows how many hairs are on your head. It says this in verse 26. Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens, who created all these. He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls forth each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. John knew God. He knew Jesus. God called John by name. And I believe with all my heart, John has found that eternal rest in glory. And actually, it's maybe not the right words to say eternal rest with John, because actually, I have no doubts that John will be there singing his heart out. We, however, who are left behind, we are left in the midst of grief and loss. And we will have those moments where our feelings, we will be overcome with sadness, and there will be times where we will laugh. And to hold all those emotions together in tension is okay. There is in this passage this promise of eternal redemption and eternal hope. It says in verse 28, "Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom." You see, this passage, it speaks of hope, speaks of redemption and comfort, with that eternal hope, but also comfort and strength here and now. With the best will in the world, John could have restored, and I believe this, he could have restored any vehicle going. If you gave him enough time, he would have done it. He could restore it and get all the parts together that he needed, could have cleaned the rust away, cleaned it all up, got it there. But ultimately, no matter how much restoration he could have done, he would never be able to get the vehicle to run without fuel, because it will always need the fuel to make it run. And in this passage, what we read is of living in God's strength rather than ours. Like that fuel, that God is with us. In the chorus of that last song are the words, "Hold me close, let your love surround me." And my prayer for each of you is that you would know God's love surrounding you. In verse 29, it continues, "He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and the young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength." And so we come back to the eagle lectern that John picked. You see, eagles are quite distinct. They're large birds, they fly, and they move through the landscape, high in the sky, but they do it primarily by soaring, rather than flapping their wings. In fact, they rarely flap. They save considerable energy as they hold their wings out and soar as they are carried on the air currents that rise. And through that soaring, they gain altitude. There is a sense in which we can trust God to carry us. Like that air current, the eagle's wings soaring out. And it says in verse 31, "But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint." And in the midst of grief and loss, we can feel weak. We can feel tired, lacking in strength and weary. But as Isaiah invites the Jews to lift their eyes above the circumstances, to look beyond what is, to look and know what truly is. That there is a hope of redemption. There is a strength that can be found here and now. To soar and trust God to give you strength. To see more than a block of wood, but to see the eagle in it. To know God comforting you, to strengthen you, holding you like those rising air currents. And so in the midst of everything that John went through, he found strength in God. He talked about his love of Jesus. And may you find that same strength, that same hope. May God hold you. May he surround you. May he comfort you. And may he fill you. Amen. We're going to sing together again. And so if you're able, would you please stand as we sing, "And Can It Be?" if you'd like to take your seats. We're going to come to a time of prayer together, and so I pray. God of mercy, Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for John, for the grace and mercy he received from you, for all that was good in his life, and for the memories we treasure today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you promised eternal life to those who believe. Remember for good this your servant John, as we also remember him. Bring all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Would you look in mercy on Alison, Claire, Karen, James, and Emma, Jesse, and Billy? And on today, which is the anniversary of John's brother Alan's death, also look in mercy on Betty, Sean, and Angela. We pray for all the family, for all John's friends, for everyone who mourns. Would you give them patient faith in times of darkness? Would you strengthen them with the knowledge of your love? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you are tender towards your children, and your mercy is over all your works. Would you heal the memories of hurt and failure? Would you give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to turn to Christ and follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of mercy, entrusting into your hands all that you have made and rejoicing in our communion with all your faithful people, we make our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. Now, one of John's requests was, rather than saying the Lord's Prayer together, we're going to sit and listen to a sung version of it.
Will be done on earth.
I invite you to stand if you're able, and we're going to sing our final hymn together, O Thou Who Camest From Above. And so let us commend John to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power Christ conquered death and entered into glory, confident of his victory and claiming his promises. We entrust John to your mercy. In the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you now and forever. Amen. We're going to move from here for the burial at Christ Church on Biddulph Moor, and then there are refreshments in the hall as well. As we come to the end of this service, I just want to pray a final prayer of blessing for each of you. May the Lord bless you and may he keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you, to be gracious to you, to fill you with his peace and his love. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen.
Is your son I might have known. If God had granted me a son, the summers die one by one, how soon they fly on, and I am old and will be gone. Bring him I might have known. If God had granted me a son, the summers die one by one, how soon they fly on, and I am old and will be gone. Let him be.